on Sunday with Hope. We spent 3 weeks on faith, and so I want to cover Hope for 2 or 3 weeks, and then we're going to do Love. That's predictable for the month of February, of course. And so in doing that, I've been through several different studies over the last 2 weeks, preparing my mind for the subject of hope. And I actually thought about doing my lesson for Sunday morning tonight. I've just invested so much on that, I want to save it for Sunday morning. And so I thought maybe what we would do tonight is go through some Bible passages that talk about hope and get some feedback on how you feel when you read these passages of Scripture, what they do for you mentally, what they do for you, and the encouragement that you receive from them, and so forth. One of my favorite Bible passages in the Old Testament is Isaiah 40:31, which just happens to be the passage that is basically the motto for the school at Smith Christian Academy. And that reminds us that if we wait upon the Lord, that he will renew our strength, that we'll mount up with wings like eagles, we'll run and not be weary, and we'll walk and not faint. If you're looking at that passage of Scripture, it's backwards. Because you don't fly before you learn to walk. Right? But it says you can mount up with wings like eagles, then you'll run and not be weary, and then you'll walk and not faint. And I've always wondered, why is it backwards? Why isn't it walk and then run and then fly? Why is it backwards? Why is it fly and then run and then walk? And I heard a professor one time say the reason why he thought that was is it describes our spiritual walk with God. Is that we start off on cloud nine. You know, we're so excited. We're just out there just doing everything we can. We're just flying high. But finally, our feet hit the ground. We realize that we have to be organized. We have to know what we need to do. We need to learn about salvation to teach other people. We need to learn about the church. We need to learn about work and service and good deeds and bearing good fruit. So we begin to run our Christian race. But as we get older, we get to a point where we're exhausted. And we've done so much. And so because of our wisdom, we have to slow down and walk. And we have to not just physically, but mentally begin our walk so that we might urge others who are starting to fly and starting to run. And I thought that was kind of a good little illustration. But in that passage, it talks about having hope. And I think we need to focus on that. We got some folks at the door. So we need to focus on how we can have that kind of hope today. So I want to start off by mentioning that the reason why I think we need to have hope is nobody would want to live a hopeless life. Nobody should say, I just want to be completely hopeless. I just don't care. And I think if people have a hopeless life, it's because of sin. So the way it goes is sin starts with this desire. James says, desire is conceived in our heart and gives birth to sin and so forth. And then once we start to sin, we start to drift. We start getting further and further away from what God's called us to do. And then, because of the deception of sin, we feel like we're enjoying it. We feel like when we sin that it's fun, it's good, it's really making me feel like I want to feel. We don't realize the damage that's going to come from it. And then, sin is always going to promise more than it delivers. It doesn't let us be free. We end up becoming enslaved to sin, and we have addiction and all kinds of other problems. And then, of course, there's only one hope, and that is Jesus. We have people enduring. So we got to have a hope in Jesus. Then, of course, a hopeless life is a dangerous life, because if you're hopeless, you're living in rebellion. You know, you're doing what you want. Nobody's going to tell you what to do. Then a hopeless life is really evidence of somebody who just refuses to accept Jesus. I don't want to do what God's called me to do. I want to know all the rules. I want to be crazy and live my life however I want. And then a hopeless life also reveals that we would rather practice the works of the flesh than the works of the Spirit. And again, there's only one answer for hope in our future, and that is to have hope with Jesus. So tonight, what I want us to do is recognize a few things in the passage we're going to see. One is that if we're in Christ, we're saved. Amen? We're saved if we're in Christ. We've come by the blood of Jesus. We've got no condemnation. There's cleansing from sin. There's justification. All those things come because we have hope. So what does that mean for people who are outside of Christ? They don't have hope, and they don't have anything listed here. They don't have salvation. They're still condemned. They still are in their sins, they're not covered by the blood of Jesus, they're not justified. And so hopefully, I use that term, hopefully we were not comfortable in this condition. And we don't want other people to be comfortable in this position. It depends on your translation, but in most of our translations, nearly 200 times, the word hope appears. And sometimes it's translated as assurance, it might be translated as confidence, it might be translated as boldness. But the term hope ought to inspire and encourage somebody. And if you don't have hope, if you are lost, that's a helpless feeling. That's a helpless feeling. I remember when I first moved to Gulf Shores, I did a lot of visitation at the congregation, and we would, if you've been down to Orange Beach and Gulf Shores area, you know, a lot of the members lived in condos, and I could not find the condo. If I couldn't find the condo, I couldn't find the unit, and I kept getting lost down there. And you can't even get lost on the beach, unless you get lost. Our secretary thought it would be funny. My birthday, she presented, well, actually, the elder presented to me, a TomTom little device where you're supposed to put, this is before I had a smartphone. I only had a smartphone for about maybe 6 years. I just didn't, I was going to keep the flip phone. I just did not want to be tempted to get on the internet all the time. And so they bought me this TomTom, and I installed it, and Jerry Brown was our youth minister at the time. He had one for his vehicle, too. And we would use it when he was with me. So I plugged that thing in, and it worked pretty good. I even got it to where it did different voices. So, like, first it was C-3PO, and then I did Yoda. That really got me confused. So finally I settled on Sean Connery. And, boy, that was great, you know. Until you get to your destination, and it was shaken and I stirred. And I thought, yeah, I want to change it back. So I used the TomTom for about a year, and one day I had a soda setting, a Coke setting in the cup holder. And it, you know how sometimes there's a condensation on the bottom of it? And I had set the TomTom down on the ground, and the condensation got on it, and it ruined the screen. And for about 6 months, I didn't tell them. Because they didn't want anybody to be upset, because everybody thought it was so funny. I had a little machine to get where I was going. And so I figured out how to Google on my phone. And you can text the word Google on any device, the numbers for G-O-O-G-L-E, and ask any question you want, you know, like movie theaters in my area, or auto parts store near me, and based on the location of your phone, even if it's not a smartphone, Google will send it to you. It's pretty cool. And so I figured out how to get directions without using the TomTom. One day, I was out visiting, and I had to call, and she said, well, just plug it into your TomTom. I said, well, that doesn't work anymore. And it was embarrassing to have to explain and then have her give me directions as to where to go. If you've ever been lost in the middle of nowhere without cell phone coverage and without a map, and you don't know where you are, and your gas is starting to run out empty, you go through this panic of, I am completely hopeless. I am helpless. When you have that experience, that's just to the nth degree of what a person feels like when they're with Jesus. The story is told of a woman who was the wife of a very prominent atheist, and he had vowed his entire life to atheism. And when he died, they had a service, like a memorial thing, not a funeral. And they had him cremated, and in the little cremains that were up there on the front, she walked to the front, and she knelt, bowed her head, and prayed. And people freaked out. They said, what is she doing? He was an atheist. She's an atheist. And she said, I just want to believe. I want to hope that this isn't the end. Even in that moment, she lost her faith in atheism and knew that something, someone must be greater than what he had lived his life for. And so she decides at that last minute to start learning about Christianity, about God. The story goes on further with her, but people will give completely up. They just, I have no hope. I just don't know what to believe. And when you meet people like that, you want to be able to share with them what you have. And hopefully it'll be contagious. They'll say, I want that too. I want to be able to know that my prayers are. Has somebody ever said that to you where they say, I just don't know if my prayers are getting heard. I just wonder if there's a God up there. I wonder if there really is if Jesus really existed. I wish, I just want to know. Well, we have the hope that they need. And so, in order to share that, we need to know where to go. So we're going to share some scriptures tonight. Ron?
This is kind of off the wall, but when you first started talking about hope, I started thinking about the word faith.
Yes.
For whatever reason. Is there any way that we could discuss the similarities and or differences between the two?
Faith actually is coupled with the word hope many times over in Scripture. In fact, Paul often used the terms faith and hope side by side. He does that 1 Corinthians 13:13, where he says, now by three things, faith, hope, and love. And it's interesting, too, when he puts the three together, he says those are the three greatest virtues. Love's the one that's greater than the three of them, if you had to put a number on them. That saying would be number one. But faith and hope do come hand in hand. In fact, in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1, it says faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. In order to have hope, you have to have faith in something. So it has to be a prerequisite. You have to have faith in order to have hope. If I don't have faith in God, I don't have a hope in heaven. If I don't have faith in Jesus, then I don't have hope in salvation. So they do have to go hand in hand. You have to, and you're going to see that in some of these passages. Faith, to be faithful, I have to have hope. I have to know that God is who he says he is, and he's going to do exactly what he promised. That's a good question. And they go together. It's a couplet, as they say. It's really a triplet when you put the faith, hope, and love together. But some of these passages will show us that they have to be tied in the same way. Any other questions or thoughts before we move to these? All right, Tyler is willingly volunteered to read our passages for us tonight. We're going to go through them one at a time. And what we're going to do is we're going to start in the Old Testament. And we're going to look at some passages in the Old Testament that tell us about hope. We're going to start in Psalm 31:24. Can you read that, Tyler? Do I need to turn the light off? I'll give it a minute. There we go. Can you read that? Can you read it with it on? Okay. Off, on. Off. Okay. Do it again.
Be good. Be of good courage, and it shall strengthen your heart, all of you who hope in the Lord.
Okay, so the psalmist says in this passage that you need to be of good courage, and he, who is he? It's all caps. Who's he? The pronoun he, that's God. And he shall strengthen your heart, all you who hope in the Lord. So he says, be of good courage. The word courage, courageous, the word confidence, the word boldness are often coupled with the word hope as well. So it's like a double portion of hope here. If you have good courage and you know that you'll gain strength, then you can look to the Lord. So I mentioned that as, I would qualify that as a heavenward hope. When we pray, where do we pray to? Who do we pray to? We're praying upward. This is the reason why in Bible times they pray like this. They would pray with their hands up. They would look to the sky. We bow our heads in reverence today. But Paul says in Timothy, you know, I would to God that all men would lift their hands in holy prayer. In other words, that's in 1 Timothy 2. He said, I wish everybody would be reverent in prayer to God, that we would talk to him. It's interesting, too, and I'm not talking about prayer specifically, but we learned in counseling that there is a position we call the praise position. If you've got a child that is inconsolable, or if you have someone that you know that cannot stop crying, it is a mindset that's learned at birth. You put them in the praise position, and they'll immediately stop crying. If you have them extend their hands up, and their head has to look towards the sky, you can't cry like that. Do you know why? What did you learn as a child when you were sad? When you were crying, what did you do? You went and you wanted somebody to hold you, right? You wanted your mom, you wanted your dad, whoever else is in the room. You know, you reach up, and if you will take a person and put them in what we call a praise position, you cannot sob uncontrollably in this position. And the reason why we use that term is because that's the way, you know, in Bible times, they praise God with their heads up and their hands lifted high. We can pray in different positions. We can pray on our knees. However, that's not the point. But the idea is we look heavenward. We look to God for salvation. We look to God for strength. We look to God for comfort. We look to God for hope. So hope has to be heavenward. And believe it or not, there are times we put our faith in people and, you know, we'll be disappointed. But if we put our faith in God, we'll never be disappointed. So our hope has to be a heavenward hope. We look up. All right, let's go to another one. Let's do this one, Tyler.
Behold, the eye of the Lord is on those who fear Him, on those who hope in His mercy.
Great. So hope in the Old Testament is expressed by the psalmist here as a merciful hope. They will receive mercy on those who hope in His mercy will be granted. So he says God's eye is on those who fear Him. So that we've got the idea of fear instilled here. If you fear God, you know you can look to Him. You know that He will guide you. He will help you. The idea of fear also comes with awe, reverence, respect. I have a fear of God. Not because I think He's going to strike my rear end with a lightning bolt every time I mess up. But I'm fearful because I know what God is able to do. If He can wipe out the entire Egyptian army like that, wipe them all out by dropping the Red Sea on them, what can He do to my enemies? If He can do that to my enemies, what can He do to me if I ever became His enemy? So there's a sense of awe, reverence, respect. And it talks about mercy, those who hope in His mercy. I hope that on Judgment Day, He is merciful to me. He will not charge to my account the sins that I've committed. I'm grateful for the mercy of God. In fact, there's a couple scriptures where the psalmist says His mercy endures forever. Forever, over and over and over, it will repeat. His mercy endures forever. His goodness forever. And so this is a great one. The mercy of God. That I need to have an understanding that the hope I have in God is because of His mercy. Because of His mercy. I'll also give another one. But it is the best illustration that I know, okay? And that is that sometimes things are repeated for a reason. Sometimes things are repeated for a reason. Because sometimes things are repeated for a reason. If you're not getting it, I'll do it again. Sometimes things are repeated for a reason. You got it. All right? Why are things repeated? There has to be a reason behind it. In Bible times, they did not use exclamation points. In fact, I'm a believer that if you're writing a tweet or a comment on Facebook, you are limited to three. Use them wisely. Some people, after every sentence, they have to exclaim because it is important. 16 exclamations! And you're just like, oh, come on, give it a break. The drama needs to rest, okay? Unless you come to your mom, that makes the drama very long. Why so many exclamations? Because they're trying to make a point! In Bible times, they didn't use exclamations. You know what they did? They repeated themselves. When Jesus gets your attention, He says, truly, truly, I say to you. Verily, verily, I say to you. So the emphasis is by saying it multiple times. Paul will say, I've told you before. Remember what I said to you. And I'm like, oh yeah. How many times did your mom have to tell you to wipe your feet before you came inside? Eventually, we get cracked with the liver. Belt or the fly swatter, you got it. Okay? I can still hear my mother saying, wipe your feet. I can still hear my mother saying, wipe your mouth, Jonesy. Or my family members that watch. We had it was her cousin. He's old enough to be my dad, you know, but every time he would eat with the family, he never wiped his face. They'd say, wipe your mouth, Jonesy. I heard that my whole life, because they said it to every kid that ever lived in that family. Probably still say it to the grandkids. Wipe your mouth, Tony. I remember you got to wipe your mouth when you eat the food. You have things your parents say to you enough, you will say it when they're gone. You can't help it. And so he says, I'm going to continually hope in you. And then notice, as if that's not enough, he says, how often is he going to do it? More and more. He says, I'm going to continually hope in you more and more and more. In other words, it's never going to end. The hope that we have in God does not end in death. It does not end in eternity. It does not end, period. Our hope is an eternal hope, a continual hope. It's like, you remember in math, I mean, thinking of math class. If you take a point and you move it forward, okay, what is that? Is that finite or is that infinite? It's finite because it had a beginning. What if there is no end and no beginning? It's infinite. It's not finite. The hope of God is infinite because God is infinite. His hope for your salvation was before you were even created. I mean, just think about that for just a minute. He already had the plan to save you 6,000 years before you were born. Your mom and dad didn't even know if you were going to be a boy or a girl on the ultrasound. Maybe you didn't have ultrasound. You just came out and said, oh, it's a boy, it's a girl, whatever. God knew, he formed you in your mother's womb. He knew you, and he knew you needed salvation thousands of years before you were ever created. His hope is a continual hope. Any thoughts? You raise your hand anytime. All right, Tyler, you ready for another one? 146.5.
Happy is he who rests in the God of Jacob for his hope, whose hope is in the Lord's God.
Oh, what? What's the first word there? What? What is it?
Happy.
Happy. I must have had masks on, but I can tell if you're smiling behind the mask or not. Happy. Happy is for Christians to be believers. To be unhappy is to be unchristian. You cannot walk around like you've been weaned out of pickle. You cannot look like you are so sour. Christians ought to be happy. They ought to be joyful. One of the reasons why people don't like Christians is because they're unhappy. I cannot sell you something if I don't believe in it. I just can't do it. I had a guy come to my house one time. He was saying, hey, would you like me to vacuum this front room for you? I said, sure. He says, I'll vacuum the whole room for free. That'd be great. Come on in. Of course, I know what he's going to do. He's going to try to sell me what? A vacuum. He's not selling a ham. He's not selling Girl Scout cookies. He's selling a vacuum. And the guy gets in there, and so I ask him any questions, and he doesn't know the answers. And he gets to a point, and he's sweating, like just sweating. And he's just back, look at this, you see how much sand was in this carpet? And he's got a quota to vacuum 20 floors, and he's got 7 left, and the sun's going down. And I finally looked at him, and I said, man, I said, why don't you just give me some water? He says, yeah, I'll take your water. And he takes it, and he drinks that whole thing of water, the whole thing. And I said, I'll get you another one. He's like, thanks, brother. He said he was thirsty. And it got to a point where he knew I wasn't going to buy it, and I knew he didn't want to sell it. He just wanted to get to the next house and back to the floor. If I tell people that there's joy in Christ, and I don't have joy in Christ, I can't sell joy in Christ. I cannot convince people that it is good to be a Christian when I don't act like it's good to be a Christian. If I don't bear the fruit of the Spirit, I'll never be able to convince somebody else to bear the fruit of the Spirit. Does that make sense? So a joyful, a happy heart has the God of Jacob for his help, and his hope is in the Lord his God. Yes? This one is this New Century Version?
Okay, because mine says blessed.
Yes.
So
it says blessed instead of happy.
And that doesn't even.
Right. Yeah, and see, happy, the word blessed in the New Testament is the same way. It can be also translated as happy or cheerful. In fact, the Beatitudes, we call them the Beatitudes because it's really like a good attitude, a happy attitude.
New King James says the same.
This is what, blessed?
New King James says happy.
The New King James says happy? Happy is the one.
Yeah, that's okay. New King James.
Yeah, so blessed can also be translated as happy or cheerful. And so I'm blessed, I'm happy about it, I'm excited, I'm full of joy because of it. And the reason why people walk around without joy is because they don't believe that they can have joy. They You'll meet people that will, they will be convinced that the reason why bad stuff happens to them is because God's not together, or because they've done something wrong. You know, I had a terrible childhood. God's just, and he's paying me back. You ever have people say, I'm paying for my razor? Like, what's that mean? You mean God goes, I'll tell you what, that one was terrible at two. Let's give him one that's terrible at two. You think God does that to you? Is that good? Well, you know, you are rude to somebody in line, and then you end up getting out in your car, and you get slow traffic. Well, I guess that's what I get. You really think God is, we throw around a word today, it is actually not a Christian thought or term. It's actually a Hindu thought and term. It's called karma. Have you never heard of karma before? People believe in karma. What goes around comes around. That's Hinduism. Hinduism teaches that if you're a good human, you might come back as a cow. If you're a bad human, you'll come back as an ant in the neighborhood of a bunch of kids that like to burn you with a micro, a little, you know, what is it? A little magnifying glass. That's what you're going to get. Or you're going to come back as a fish, and you're going to get eaten. That's what karma is. You're going to get what's coming to you. God's not got karma. In fact, last time I checked, God causes the sun to rise on, how does that go? The just and the unjust. So, if I'm understanding my scriptures right, God is good to both those that are good and bad. So then how is God about karma? He's not. God is good to all. What I do with that goodness is my choice. Listen, if everybody were to be treated with karma, there's not a Christian that wouldn't have $1 million bank account. Hello? I mean, if God was really a God of karma like that, well, those that comes around, what you get, what you, then you would never have to worry about money. You'd never have to be worried about food. You'd never have to work a day in your life. Everything just fall right in your life. That's not the way that works. You have to work for it. A man is only worth what he can work for. And therefore, Paul says, if you don't work, you shouldn't eat either. You're right.
You know, when you say, what comes around goes around, or it just seems like if you're doing what's right, or if you're doing what's not right,
right,
sooner or later,
right,
it's gonna come back.
Sure.
It might not be until after you physically die, but sooner or later it's coming right. back, right?
Right. My best illustration, I used to use Job a lot. Say, Job's a good example. What did Job do bad? Didn't do nothing bad. What does kids do bad? Didn't do nothing bad. The devil killed all of them. All his kids, all his servants, all his livestock. He got killed. I mean, God allowed him to kill everything, but Job. But in the end, you're right. Job does get what's coming to him. So let's go to another example. Abraham.
Oh, wait.
Oh, he needs Abraham.
Okay. I just want to say this. Sometimes it seems to me that there might be a person that's on the wrong side of the tracks.
Okay.
And then that person will get busted, go to jail for 10 years or 15 years, you know, and I'm having a difficult time expressing my thoughts here about it, but it's like, you know, it's easy for me to say, well, he well deserved it.
Right.
He got what was coming
to him. Right.
But at the same time, the Bible says it rains on the just and the unjust.
Right.
So, you know, sometimes my common sense and my logic is not necessarily reality.
Yes. And I did a lesson one time where I had everybody, we took a congregational vote, and I had seven paper plates with faces on it. And I said, we're going to pretend that we're the judge in a courtroom. And I'm going to give you their story, and you're going to choose death penalty, life in prison, or set them free. And I went through all seven stories. And I started with Simon. And I talked about how he had a filthy mouth. He had a problem dealing with others. He was probably one of the most racist, prejudiced people you'd ever meet. Didn't like people of different color. Didn't like people who spoke a different language. He publicly, openly denied that Jesus was not the Christ. He didn't believe in Jesus. Didn't ever follow Jesus. Didn't want anything to do with Jesus. And I got down to the end, and I did that with the seven characters. And all seven characters were model characters. Simon was Peter. And the entire congregation voted to give him the death penalty. I did Paul. I called him Solomon, I think, so I changed it from Saul to Solomon. This guy executed Christians. What would you do? Give him the death penalty. And all seven Bible characters were individuals who, by the end of their life, turned things around. Peter made a lot of blunders. Paul made a lot of blunders. David, goodness. I mean, you talk about David. Here's a guy who, I mean, it didn't matter what council you're on, he had 12 votes, it'd be 12, 100% across the board every time. He gets to die for what he did. And he even told Jonathan. I mean, talk about cruel, talk about cold, calculated. Forget about what he did with Uriah and Bathsheba for a moment. Think about what he did with his best friend, Jonathan. Jonathan, don't worry, David. When you're dead and gone, I'm going to take care of all your kids and your grandkids. I'll tell you what, they're going to be safe. They're going to live with me in the palace. I'm alone. I'm going to give them. Oh, Jonathan's dead. Kill them all, boys. Kill every last one of them. Every, if they got me, even if it was a servant of Jonathan, I want him dead. That's David. A man after God's own heart. The scriptures confirm that every Bible character, they're there for a reason. They show us a pattern. People are sinners. People are worthless. I mean, we're awful. I mean, I declare I love God today. And then tomorrow I'm going to be doing something else to prove that I don't love my brother. And John says, how can you say you love God and don't love your brother? You're a liar, is what you are. If you're a Christian, you can't treat your brother bad. You can't say bad things about your brother or your sister. You love them no matter what. So all the Bible characters, they just kill them all. They just kill them all. And I said, you just killed off apostles. You killed off kings. You killed off men and women who by the end of the Bible, Rahab. What do you do with this woman? You know, what do you do with her? Well, put her in the genealogy of Jesus. That's what God did. I mean, it's just, what in the world? The scriptures are stories that are meant to affect you emotionally. You get wrapped up and you say, how did this happen? And God uses every single one. So Abraham's a great example. Going back, I want to chase that rabbit, didn't I? I said I want to chase that rabbit. So Abraham, God comes to Abraham. And he says, here's what I need you to do. I need you to pack. I need you to just get up. I need you to get out. And don't ever come back here. Abraham is a multi-billionaire. He owns the town. His dad's inheritance is going to give him the entire property. He's got everything he ever needed, everything he ever wanted, and some. He's the richest man they ever knew. In fact, he was legendary with his money. God says, I need you to get up, I need you to go. And I'm going to give you so many descendants, kids, grandkids. Man, you can't even count the stars in the sky. There are so many, it's more than the sand of the sea. He made it to the beach. How many sands are there? How many? Trillions. A Google amount. I mean, it's incalculable. You could not, if I gave you a bucket of sand, you'd be here in 40 years, still counting every grain of sand. But if some of them you mix up, there's two there. He said, I'm going to give you as many sands as seashore. That's how many kids you're going to have. Abraham lives to the right old age. When Abraham died, how many sons did he have? Dose. That we know of at first. We have Isaac and Ishmael. Now he marries Keturah, and he has, what, six or eight more after that? So, 10 kids. Most of us have 10 toes, right? 10 fingers. God said, what? I'm going to give you as many as the sand of the seashore, the stars of the sky. On a starry night, I can count more than 10. I can take my shoes off and count more than 20. How many kids did Abraham have? Okay, all right, maybe that's not fair. So Abraham doesn't get that promise. Isaac, his son. How many kids does Isaac have? Dose. Jacob, and Esau. All right, take hands. How many? Two. Can you count two? Is that the sand of the seashore? Is that the stars in the sky? No. If you put two and ten, you can still do it. Hands and feet, that's 12. That's not. That doesn't make any sense. Okay, so Ishmael, let's take Ishmael. How many kids did Ishmael have? Ishmael had 12 kids. All right, so let's take 12 like that. 24. Can you count to 24? I got two generations of Abraham's seed on the earth. Is that as many as the sand of the seashore? Is that as many as the stars in the sky? Nope. All right, well, let's be fair. Let's go to the third generation after Abraham. Remember, Abraham's dead and gone now. But the third generation of Abraham, the God of Jacob. Remember Jacob? Let's talk about Jacob. Jacob had how many kids? He had 12 sons of Leah that has the 12 tribes. There's another one in there, so count 13. He's got Leah, or not Leah, he's got Dinah as a daughter. So he's got, 12, 13, 14 kids. Can you count that many? Can you count to 14? Yeah. So now we're in the third generation of kids. When they enter into Egypt, the Bible says that we're 70. That included the children, the grandchildren, and the great-grandchildren, and Jacob, 70. Can you count to 70? That's four generations past Abraham. Four. Is that the sand of the seashore? Is that the stars in the sky? No. Abraham is given a promise that he would never see answered. He says to his son Isaac, "Isaac, I want to share with you a promise God gave to me, and he's going to give to you." Isaac never saw it answered. Jacob comes along. Isaac says to Jacob, "I'm going to give you a promise that was given to me by my father Abraham. It was given to him by God." Jacob never saw it answered. Then you've got the 12 sons. The 12 sons say to their sons, "Our dad, Jacob, gave us a promise that was given by his dad, Isaac, that was given by his dad, Abraham, that was given by the God of heaven." And they didn't see it answered. Five generations, six generations, seven generations, 400 years pass by before they leave Egypt. The promises that God makes, we expect to have automatic fulfillment because that's the way God is. He ought to do it right now. He ought to talk about it right now with her. He ought to do it. Why are you doing it? Why are you answering it? I asked him yesterday. I asked him the day before. That's been on my mental pack prayer list for the last 6 weeks. Why isn't God answering me? Why isn't he hearing me? Why isn't he doing this? Why isn't he doing that? God's promises are meant to give us assurance in the moment, but it doesn't mean that there's an answer. It may take a lifetime, or two lifetimes, or three lifetimes to see this thing. You know what? The world is going to experience some changes in 400 years because of your prayers today. Let me think about that for just a minute. The Israelites prayed to be delivered for 400 years before it happened. How many of you prayed for peace in the Middle East? Haven't seen it yet. Have you seen it yet? How many of you pray for peace in our country? Have you seen it yet? It gets worse every single day. Your prayers may not, probably will not, may not be answered in your lifetime. But that doesn't render the promise of God as unimportant or real. It's just as real. When we pray for something, we cannot expect automatic fulfillment. That would make God like, the Santa Claus that every time I go to him and give a list, as long as I'm approved it from mom and dad, is going to get exactly what I want on the tree on December 25th. That's not the way God works. See, God is a great father. And he knows that I don't need ice cream and sugar every night to go to bed. He knows that I don't have to have the best car to drive, the best house to live in. He knows that I don't need those things. Because he knows that if I had them, I wouldn't appreciate anything else but that. So God gives us what we're able to handle. That's why his promises are continual, forever, and never end. The hope of eternal life ought to give us some sense of, credibility in it. Give us a sense of joy in this moment, even though I don't see it. Anybody ever seen heaven before? Anybody ever seen God's face before? Anybody ever seen Jesus, even for just a minute, other than a picture or a drawing? But yet we know that there's a God, and we know that Jesus died on the cross, and we know that there is a heaven. I've never seen the mansion John talks about. I've never seen the characters of the Bible, yet I know that those things exist. Because I have hope.
What would you preach tonight? I will preach.
All right, give me another one, Tyler.
The hope of the righteous will be gladness, but the expectation of the wicked will perish.
So this is the sad commentary, the opposite side. So hope gives me this idea that if I am right with God, and really there's none righteous, so I'm not one, right? I'm just doing my very best that I can. It's kind of like, you know, when your kids do finger painting. I've got some finger painting and some drawings. I found one, I'll probably use it as a sermon illustration one day. And Luke drew me a picture of Captain Rex from Star Wars. if Brandon was here, his bird goes back enough. He was here, he would know what I'm talking about. He drew me a picture of Captain Rex, and he put on the bottom, "Daddy, I love you. I'm sorry I had to get 154 spankings today." Now I know he didn't get 154 spankings. First of all, that age couldn't count that high. And second of all, I don't have the energy to give 154 spankings even at that age. But to him, it was an exaggeration of the fact that he knew he had done wrong, and he knew the punishment he was going to receive. And he's now apologizing to me for whatever he did, which I don't even remember, and he draws this picture. Now, does it look like Commander Rex? No. He's got a helmet on, I can tell that, you know. So he's a stormtrooper, clone trooper. So I kept that along with a whole bunch of other things, but it's a reminder to me of the situation, whatever it was he was in. He felt sorry for whatever he did. And when I think about the drawings that my kids drew for me, they have to tell me, you know, have kids, you know, that awkward moment, and they're like, "Oh, it's a duck. It's a beautiful duck." I'm like, "No, Daddy, that's you." "Oh, okay. This is the tree, and I love that house, buddy. That's a beautiful, no, that's a rocket ship." "Okay, well, what about the tree?" "No, that's Mama." "You know, okay." "Well, she's thinner than I am, because I look, okay." So you know what I'm talking about. You don't understand what it is. It's a little drawing. You know, your kids do stuff like that. We'll never live up to the standards that God has set. But the good news is because Jesus has taken our place, we don't have to. We simply do our best. We try our best. But the wicked don't have that hope. Their destination is totally different. If we really believed that our friends and family members were lost, if we really believed they were destined for fire, if we really believe that, how should we react? You know, if I see my neighbor's house is on fire tonight, and I look out and go, "Oh, let's do that." Or if I call them up and say, "Hey, your house is on fire." Or if I call 911 for them, but I don't do anything else except back to sleep. But we will pass tracks to people. You know, we'll text them and say, "Hey, watch getting near your bottle." "I am." You know. But if I really believe people are destined for fire, I would be using every ounce of my energy to try to convince them to change their direction. So here he says the hope is for those that are righteous, not for the wicked. They're going to perish. Alright, we got another one? Alright, one more.
"You are weird in the length of your ways. Yet you do not say, 'There is no hope.' You have found the life of your hands. Therefore, you were not greedy."
Yes. I had an illustration I was going to say for Sunday. I'll go ahead and use it now real quick. Stories of a man who, he told the preacher, appreciated listening, and he said, "You know, I've been praying for you." He said, "That's great." He said, "You know, we came to visit you," says Greg. And he said, "I got a question. Every time I come see you, you got empty chairs to your bed." And he goes, "That's intentional." And the preacher said, "Well, I'm curious why you keep an empty chair next to you. Is it because you expect visitors?" He said, "Absolutely not." And so, "What's the empty chair for?" And he says, "Well, your predecessor, the preacher that was here before you, told me one time that if I had trouble praying, that I should put an empty chair out and pretend Jesus is in the chair. If I pray to that empty chair, and I believe with all my heart that Jesus is in that chair, it would help me pray. He said, so now in my last days, I look at that chair and imagine Jesus there. I imagine Jesus wanting to hold me, even though I can't get up out of this bed. I imagine Jesus holding me when I talk to him in prayer. Pretty sure that's pretty cool. That's really neat. I've never heard of that before. And he leaves. Well, the man died the night. And the preacher goes to talk to the daughter and says, did he go peacefully? And she said, yes. But she said it was the oddest thing. She said, you'll never guess how I found him. She said, I didn't think he had the strength to do it, but he was out of the bed on his knees with his face in this chair. And the preacher said, I know exactly what he was doing. He said, I hope that I have enough faith when I leave this world that I leave just like he did. I want my face buried in the bosom of Christ to be in the lap of Jesus and take it home. That's what that man did. He got just enough strength. Now, I know it's symbolic. I know that it's just a chair. But that man, he believed that Jesus was sitting in that chair. That's pretty cool, isn't it? That's the kind of hope we're talking about, a steadfast hope. And he says, even when you're weary and you're weak, you still say, there is hope. You know, Paul, when he was put to death, he was beheaded in Rome. The tradition says it's possible Peter and Paul were either killed on the same day or within the same week. There was a tremendous persecution going on at that time. And Paul said, no problem, I'll get my head willingly. But before he went to have his head cut off, he got on his knees and he prayed. And he prayed so earnestly, so emphatically in his prison cell that it converted the guards that were there with him. There are men and women who went to the stake to be burned. They had their bodies thrown to the lions, the Roman Colosseums. And they were more than willing to give their life because they had hope of eternal life. You see, this doesn't matter. This flesh is going to pass away. I'm just temporary. We're all just temporary. But if we have our hope in something else, in someone else, and we think about heaven every single day, I'm sure one day when I die, it's going to be a car wreck because I can't stop looking at clouds. Do you know why I look at clouds? Why do I look at clouds so much? Because I'm looking to see if Jesus is coming back. I think I said before, I tell the kids all the time, I hope when Jesus comes back, if I can create a youth group t-shirt or a church t-shirt, there'd be a cape on the back. And a cape on the back in the front of it saying, get ready for Jesus is coming, okay? Because I want to have a cape on, and I want to take flight when Jesus comes again. That's the hope of eternal life, the hope of heaven. I can't wait to get there. I'm not going to speed up, okay? But I can't wait to get there. Last one, we'll finish with this one.
It is good that one should hope and wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord.
So our hope is a quiet hope. We wait. We wait quietly. We wait patiently. In other words, we don't scream out of the sky. You know, when are you going to do this, God? When is this going to happen? We know that God ultimately is going to do it whenever he chooses to and however he chooses to. And I think, I don't know when Jesus is going to come again. But I know that as Paul said, that Thessalonians comfort myself and others, we comfort one another with these words, that we'll know that when he calls our name, that we'll be ready to go. The question we have to ask ourselves is, are we ready for that moment? Are we ready to go? Like if Jesus called your name tonight, are you ready to go? Are you ready to meet Jesus? And that's a fact. That's important. So he says, quietly wait in hope for the Lord. And so I want to encourage you to think about what you need to do to change to be more in line with the will of God. What can you do to be more like Jesus? Make those changes because they're necessary. They're important. And if we make those changes and we know that we're going to be saved, then we need to take that and we need to share it with others as well. All right, any other comments or thoughts, complaints or criticisms before we conclude tonight? All right. Well, let's conclude with a prayer. And Stephen, would you mind leading us in prayer tonight?